Staying the same. Mm-hmm. Haven't seen any changes quite yet.
I mean, I would replace this with a tag ban over Sivir, honestly, if I was Splice. I think the Sivir ban makes sense. This is what they did last game. You guys can see it on your screen too. But Tarek just had a really large impact, and Vander hasn't been even forced in the entirety of playoffs so far to reveal what his next pickup would be.
Yeah, Tarek very much feels like the anti-teamfight champion, because every time you try to force something, you're getting in the midst of things. Oh, you land that massive wombo combo? No! You actually do absolutely zero damage, and it's very difficult for you to have any real impact. But Splice, they're saying, hey, we have a plan. You know, game one was just us warming up throughout the day. You know, we need a bit of vamp time, but they're going to stick with their original plan, and that is likely going to result in H2K going for that first Rek'Sai rotation once again.
Splice believe in their research, and they say, you know what? It works, we just misplayed. H2K may think another step apart here, and they must have a discussion of potentially not going Rek'Sai and maybe even getting an early tag, because they might be afraid that it gets stolen here. Splice, they're looking to shake things up here, because obviously there's no Tahm Kench priority on the side of HGK since they value Tarek so much, so they can actually leave a Tahm Kench pick for later and just do the same first rotation as they did earlier, except replace the Ashe pick with a Taliyah.
Something that both Wonder and Senkux are very experienced on, of course, most likely going to the hands of Senkux this time around, short of something crazy, but a very strong pick, rising in popularity, and Splice have learned from their mistakes in game one.
Don't toy with my emotions, Ryu. This is by far my favorite champion, and it's not going to be picked, because into Taliyah, high mobility mages, assassins in particular, are actually very good into her, because she doesn't have very many escapes at her disposal. So champions like Fizz in particular can be very impactful. Unlikely to see it, the more likely would be something like the AP Echo that we have been seeing rising in popularity more recently. So that could be something that Ryu looks to pick up for himself, but once again, with the Echo still available, you could then rotate that up to the top lane or the mid lane, given that it is still a very solid pick into the Gnar.
Overall, looking at it like it is going to be the Echo as well as the Ashe locked in. H2K on a similar path. The Taliyah now swapped out for the Ashe. And interesting as we line this up, what do you think is the logic behind the priority on Gnar on the side of Splice?
Well, it looks like that they're trying to make sure that Wonder is in a favorable matchup, because there are very few things that actually just straight up stomp the Gnar. Because of his range advantage, because of how well he does into the majority of matchups, he doesn't typically fall behind. And so by going for the early Gnar, it just guarantees a safe lane for Wonder in which he can build his own advantage.
And we will see the Gragas Gnar combo very likely come out again here. So maybe this is something they practice in scrims too. You know, they have a bot lane that can always fend for itself with Tahm Kench. It's incredibly hard to get kills there. Maybe a CS advantage. Mid lane Taliyah will now have the control, and they can honestly do the same thing that they did last game. They can punish this Echo in the top lane 3-6 because he doesn't have his ultimate available. He's actually really easy to kill if you get there. You know, with a Gragas, that's probably going to be the fifth rotation pick here. And then the Gnar and potentially Taliyah roam on 6.
And slight adjustments to both sides on the picks and ban, but the core feels relatively the same. Kabi getting Jhin, another utility champion. The Tahm Kench still seeing priority here on the side of Splice, but we've left that Taric open now.
But honestly, HGK could go Vladimir here, and then a Ghost champion plus Taric is a really nice combo, especially if you have like Ashe Arrow to start a fight, zoning W from Echo, you have Rek'Sai tunneling in with proxy stun, or you have Vladimir ghosting in with proxy stun from Taric. Possible here, because both Taliyah and Jhin are very vulnerable to backline dives.
And very interesting, of course. I think the most terrifying thing about that, Taric, is giving Echo a stun. Giving Echo a reliable stun on so much mobility already. So if Odo gets ahead one more time, if they do opt for the Taric, it's going to be rough for Splice once again.
But it holds the risk that H2K play with losing matchups, and I think that is exactly why they may pivot from that strategy and pick up a range support.
And it looks like they're going to go for the Karma to guarantee themselves
nope.
a bit more aggression. Nope!
You're
they
wrong, Vettius! Set you up!
You set me up for that!
Vettius, why are you so wrong?
It's like, make sure Vetti starts talking, 3 seconds left on the champion select, I'm gonna juke the Karma.
Boom!
That's for calling me having no fan, Vetti. Fanders.
Wild card, Vettius!
Pro player connection.
So H2K drafting a very similar composition to what they had before, but they do have now more losing lanes than they did in game one. The Ashe, Taric, not quite as formidable as the Lucian, and the same in the mid lane, because they don't have the Taliyah. They are now going to be the ones that are getting regularly pushed underneath their turret.
Yeah, they have the risk of losing all three lanes here. However, Ashe, Taric probably can get the push on Jhin Tahm Kench, but the Tahm Kench Jhin lane is a super fun one to watch, because if the Taric overreaches, if he goes for a too aggressive stun, he'll get wrecked. It takes Tongue Lash into Deadly Flourish, which boots him for long enough for another auto attack Q to then follow up afterwards into a Devour, spit out the Taric, and he's eating so much damage, and Ashe can't react to all of that here. So again, it is a similar story from game one. We have to track Jankos and Thrash. We have to judge their paths, see how they switch it up, if there's any outplay. And Jankos, you see him already, like, he has to lead his team because he is the captain of the early game ship.
Absolutely. Of course, the remaining the First Blood King here, a phenomenal game one performance coming in from him, but Thrashy and the rest of Splice, we wanted more deep vision. We wanted them to respect Jankos more, and we have to wonder if they're going to adapt to that pressure that Jankos has been putting down early.
Now, bear in mind, Splice have changed up their composition a little bit more because they have a lot more kite in their comp this time. You have the Gragas for disengage, you have the Talia for disengage, and then you also have easy setup for the Jhin to land those deadly flourish to guarantee them the stun. So they have a couple more options in like kiting back, but they still have other ways to also force fights around these big objectives, which is what Splice likes to do.
And honestly, if Splice can get a level 5 swap off, that might actually be the ticket for them to win it. They'll have a winning matchup in Gnar versus Ekko, hopefully with some pressure from Thrashy. If they can then push out bot somehow base and switch their bot lane to top lane, get that, you know, the first turret play that Unicorns have loved it, and then open up the map, they can play their 1-3-1 very beautifully and masterfully as they usually do. That may be a Splice's game plan here, you know. Not go for the 2v2 outplay, just push, swap to top side, get some tier 1 towers, end up trading them, and then play the open map, you know, with the Tahm Kench and the Talia.
Of course, we are getting ready, getting geared up here for game two, but you know, it's good that you point that out because I think what we're seeing from Splice is so much flexibility in this composition. You've got more mobility with the Tahm Kench, with the Talia, but the team fight combo.
The ominously dark in here.
They're just saying mood lighting.
Mood lighting.
As we're getting ready for game two of this best of five.
Hey, that's us.
Hey, that's us in the
dark. In the darkness. LCS after dark.
An old friend of ours, you could say.
Ladies and gentlemen, game two. Welcome to Summoner's Rift. You pushing up teams and have to judge their level one setups. And Senkux spending a little bit of quality time with his bot lane.
Ah, some queso, as Nicky likes to call it. Brush check with you. Just to make sure nobody's hiding.
Do love me some queso. Senkux.
I don't know what a queso is.
Queso is cheese.
Cheese in Spanish.
Ah.
Cheese in Spanish, yeah.
You would. Have you ever eaten quesadilla?
Yes.
All right. Come on, deduction.
The core word. What is the core word of quesadilla?
That's a good point.
Dia?
Dia, Fedius.
Can I have a Dia, please?
Moving in. Vision being laid down.
Ward. It's honestly underrated. Just sneaking in a cheeky little ward like that, it just tells you everything you need to know about the enemy jungle path. Because a jungler like Gragas isn't going to skip his red buff, right? Just because he knows there's a ward there. So, and you can tell if somebody's leashing too. Because all these junglers right now, they get the nice treatment of power leashes. However, Splice has done the same. Enemy red buff. Ooh, he's... Oh, queso! I mean, Dia.
Moving in.
It's actually not queso. What he tries to do there is an old mid lane strategy. Because he can't get challenged on his way back because he's Talia into Vladimir. He'll have Q up again soon. What you do is you press Talia Q on the Raptors and you take two or three of them down. And then you have a quicker level up and you spike level up on the first wave. Because normally, obviously, it takes the first creep of the second wave to level up.
Yeah, and this was actually something that we saw last week in the Unicorns game where Exile actually went and took just a couple of the early camp or one of the early Raptors to guarantee that level up to get the early push. Now we see a trait in the bottom.
That's exactly what you were talking about. Vander set to fall. Ignite ticks.
Oh,
is it going to be enough? Is it going to be enough? Kavi, he's not getting the shots off. Vander makes it out. Oh!
Kavi, you failed! You're supposed to heal for the speed boost. Don't be greedy. Take the first blood. Major misplay by Kavi here. Mickey did everything he could to set up his AD carry for that kill. He fumbled.
And that's exactly what you were talking about in picks and bans. The tongue lash, deadly flourish, get those extra autos,
I mean,
eat him up.
He was level one.
Oh, yeah. He only had devour. No, uses the tongue, but it's not the tongue lash. Just the...
Multiple uses.
Multiple uses of the tongue.
But this is good for Splice, being able to get so many summoners down for H2K. Notice that, remember in game one where Jankos came in for that very early level three to punish the fact that Mickey wasn't that level three mark, didn't have that great health just yet, and now Splice already building this advantage, forcing those summoner spells down, allows Thrashy to then rotate back to this bottom half, if he so chooses to enable further advantages to be gained for Splice.
Now both junglers got spotted on their initial clear. We didn't quite keep track of any pings here, but Jankos still going for the Raptors here. But it starts off with Mickey. One attack, two attacks. Deadly flourish, because Kavi was level two because they started Gromp here. And like right here, you heal and you flash. Heal! Press heal! Nope! And now he heals. Like, come on, Kavi.
Bear in mind, though, there was a really good exhaust as well coming out from Vander,
yeah, but he was
just as the crit was coming out to negate, which would have been a kill shot.
Yeah, perfect exhaust there, but still, like, Kabi was waiting for the exhaust to wear off to maybe get in range, but then he was trying not to waste heal on the level 1 on enemy support.
Small mistakes with a story for Splice in the last game. This time around, it doesn't cost them much, but First Blood would have been a nice boon to have, and we've seen what small advantages can lead to. But of course, top side of the map, Jankos making a repeat appearance here. Playing game one all over
fine,
again.
This time he is fine because there's no Taliyah following the roam here. Obviously, Wunder will be challenged a little bit, and he's both getting dove here, but it wasn't just to Rek'Sai last game. We have to reiterate that. It was a Rek'Sai plus Taliyah roam together.
Yeah.
And now that their summoner is blown on the bottom lane too, Senkux will be 6 before these 5 star back up here. So that's the spike Splice want to play for. Hopefully they can preserve the teleport on Wunder. And then they can make a 5 lane bot lane party. And maybe lose that pressure on the turret.
To see how they adapt, of course, have the Taliyah as well. Easier for them to make a party. Ryu doesn't have quite as many tools to make responses of his own. So it's going to require some very heads up play in the mid lane from H2K. But Splice taking this opportunity to clear out a bit of vision. Using that pressure advantage.
Forgiven did throw out the Hawkshot to see if he could spot out Trashy, looking for a potential gank in the bottom half of the map. But Trashy, very cleverly, able to avoid it by hugging the left side of the wall of Krug. So that means that right now, the knowledge of where Trashy was wasn't known to H2K until he decided to walk onto this mid lane ward, which Ryu then quickly interrupted his back. And now Trashy is going to be forced to back away at not the ideal timing, because Jankos is now in a great opportunity to get a bit of deep vision down and set up that pink ward in the bottom half of Splice's jungle.
Yeah, Ryu got a couple of base cancels off there too. It really slowed down the progress of Splice if they want to play the map here. Oda coming back with teleport and getting a good chunk here. That basically solidifies that Wunder will have to match teleport, because Splice is not ready as a team to go for that bot lane play. So HK did a really couple subtle things here. The fact that Ryu cancels both backs, Jankos put pressure, Senkux right now is basing like a full minute later than he would have liked.
Definitely not where they wanted to be. Once again, H2K taking control. A little bit slower this time around than in the previous game.
Ooh, teleport top with the ward just faded. A ward just faded. So Oduana used to feel safe here in this position. But he's level 6 already, and Wunder wants to catch up the farm. So Strashy, yeah.
Backing off in the end, and he's not even going to find much of anything in this jungle because Jankos has been taking everything. We'll get the Krugs. Raptor's already gone.
Could have been an opportunity here,
yeah,
but
that could have been
just
massive.
Got 6.
Really could have been a big opportunity. Unfortunately, for Splice, Wunder was still only level 5, and now Odo waiting for a potential gank. And you can also see Yanko sitting in the top half of the jungle.
But the Taliyah hiding in Fog of War is all she needs to do right now. Look at Senkux on the minimap. He doesn't even need to move to the bottom lane. The second if it disappears from the vision, H2K will back up off, give Liberty and Kobe, and give Kobe and Mickey lane control if they so choose to put.
Playing with that vision. Strong mental game coming in from Splice here. Have to see what H2K want to do.
Oh, Wunder.
Oh, that's a pink ward.
That's
You're definitely just delivering yourself. Oh, Wunder, how's he gonna get out? Knockup comes in. Dizzy cancel the jump, knock back into the wall, leaps over.
Honestly. Yeah, you have to go for the knockup of Jankos. Technically, you can wait. See if you can cheese out the jump cancel, because you never kill him unless you cancel jump here. But they force the ultimate.
Yeah.
Put some pressure. Sometimes kill isn't all you need. Pressure can be enough.
Certainly can be. And speaking of pressure, you can see Splice putting a lot of damage down onto this tier 1 in the bottom lane. A completely different early game to what we saw from game 1, where Splice were really struggling under the pressure from Jankos, who is now going to be trashy in the jungle. He's just going to swag his way out of that one.
Ooh, you can see how busy both junglers have been, because we're at 7 minutes 30 seconds and neither of them are level 6 here. Good devour from Kobe, from Mickey rather. But on second spawn of buffs, junglers usually hit level 6 right when they finish that buff, right? Both of them still level 5 here.
You can also see the difference in how they've been busy, because Jankos has been primarily trying to set up ganks in the top half of the map. Whereas Trashy has been focusing on vision. Look at all this line of vision that you can see in H2K's entrances to the jungle. And this is all from Trashy just going for that very early tracker's knife and being able to track where Jankos is going. Something that we've praised Trashy for throughout this play.
I was trying to see it, but that is had his hands on the screen. It's like, look at all this information. I'm like, bro, you're covering the minimap.
It's my turn to be the color caster.
Weatherman, Vedius.
He's got it. Of course, Trashy has to back out here. Doesn't want to stay around for that fight, but we talked about the bottom lane at least a little bit, a 10 CS advantage in the favor of Splice. And
against Forgiven, of all people, that's like a 20 CS advantage.
Purely in the fact that it's never happened before, of course.
Well, I actually was down against Reckless.
Look, so man, it sometimes like I just need to say stuff, and I need you to follow me into the abyss.
Yeah, it never happened. Wow! Unique event in history, Forgiven down in CS. Oh.
Special
Tiger
to me, Krepo.
Flying blue buff.
Flea.
Gonna be a little bit more comfortable.
Krepo.
All right, Senkuk's just gonna clear out these waves. Are you moving into the jungle? Yanko's backing him up. They're gonna take control of the vision pressure that they've built in the mid lane. Now Yanko's maybe looking to make an appearance on the top side, but Senkuk's not quite so easy or eager to give up that pressure.
So this mid lane matchup has actually gone a little bit differently to what we saw before, because Ryu has been playing a lot more aggressively than initially, because he was actually going for a lot more trades early on, which means that Senkuk was a little bit scared to push up the lane, which is why he fell a little bit behind early on in farm, and why he was forced to back at an inopportune moment, which is why we haven't seen as many roaming opportunities as Senkuk would have liked.
Yeah, he doesn't really roam, he just hides in fog of war, cleans like pink wards like this. It's a pressure that builds up, however, it's given Ryu a relatively easy early laning phase doing that, because where he could spend time harassing Ryu as Ryu cleans up CS, he just takes the time to leverage that advantage to bottom him. However, Ryu went for a very heavy magic resistance build here, combined with the fact that he's Vladimir, and he has a tiny bit of sustain built in his kit. Just ever a pinch. He's actually really hard to kill or pressure out for Senkuk now.
Yeah, we're waiting on the Morel and Omicron to come in, but even once Senkuk's get it, he still has to get him to that low health threshold, and that may require some support from Trashy. But the mid lane really has not been the focus point for either of these teams, once again, using the Taliyah in the side lanes, more the goal. But Wonder, Odo, both with the teleports, a lot of opportunities for playmaking.
Yeah, and if we notice in the bottom lane, you can see a very deep ward in the lane of H2K, which could be an opportunity for Wonder to come in and flank from behind. Summoner spells are available for Forgiven and Vander, but other than that, Trashy also making his way to the bottom.
You have to hurry, though. There's only 20 seconds left on that ward. It's Trinket Ward, about 20% remaining right here, but they're looking for a play here. Tension is building up in this series. Gonna kill it long. You pull his force, but this forces mid push, which can move just walking down the bottom lane. Sometimes you can do it in full vision. You can tell your opponents that this is actually a move. They have to prevent Forgiven from cleaning out this wave if they want to execute. If not, they can turn this advantage into a free dragon suit.
Mickey stepping forward, trying to get that advantage, but Taliyah and Gragas back off.
So afraid to pull the trigger here, Spice, though, because Ryu can't match with teleport. Dragon's free too. Yankos does show up, but yeah, you have to wonder, could they have pulled it, or are they so afraid of this Taric invulnerability on the dive?
Of course, it cost them so much in game one, not respecting it. They had so many great opportunities canceled out by that single ability, maybe forcing them to hesitate a bit more in game two.
Notice that Wonder did use his teleport actually to get back into lane, which means that Odo will have that advantage.
Then they should have swapped. If they do that, honestly, then I feel like Kobe and Mickey should have just went top here, surprise Odo in his lane, he still has to back, and then just whack away on the turret. You know, four man plus Taliyah, they can guarantee themselves for a turret.
And it's very interesting that you mentioned that, because when this patch first came out, we expected so many more lane swaps.
They're doing it. They're doing it too late. And this is something we haven't really seen from Splice. Hesitation. Unless they were waiting for a sign of lane assignments from HK, but I doubt it. I think they just made up this move, but it cost them 10 seconds of thinking power, which is 10 seconds of map play that they lost.
Now H2K actually gaining control around the dragon. They definitely know that something is up. They get spotted out on a ward, and the immediate response comes out from H2K.
The good old days of lane swaps.
No, this is like a mini base race. One man.
Get the camp
one
set up.
One desire.
One mission.
Moving down, H2K well ahead of the curve here. Echo doing such a good job of clearing the waves, and this means this tower is going to fall. The first blood bonus goes over to H2K, and this is going to put them well in the lead.
Just echoes back to what we were talking about earlier. This place should have been set up earlier with the use of the teleport coming out from Wonder. They could have got the surprise onto Odo, perhaps caught H2K off guard, and now H2K have the massive tempo advantage, and they're already going to get knocking on that tier 2 target score.
Splice aren't used to performing this play, you can tell, because something is breaking down in the communication, because the wave wasn't there. HK is pushing on tier 2. They didn't even use the Tahm Kench ultimate to get into position quicker, so they lost 10 seconds and potentially 6 seconds of travel time by not using Tahm Kench ultimate here. So Splice behind on the macro against H2K, something we weren't really seeing throughout the normal season of the LCS, but it's playoffs.
And not only does that cost them the first tower, the first blood gold advantage, but 2/3 of the health on that bottom side tier 2. Trashy forced to use that ultimate to clear the waves. As you mentioned, a little bit of communication breakdown here in Splice, clearly on the back foot, whatever the cause.
With Cloud Drake now on the board, not really an objective that either team wants to hard commit for, but they'll try and pick it up if they see a clean opportune moment. This H2K had a brief opportunity there where instead they could have just shoved the wave underneath the tier 2 and rotated around and picked up the Drake. Mm-hmm. Instead, they look to try and push the tempo advantage, not respecting the fact that Splice had the immediate response. They realized very early the bad situation that they were in and were able to stop losing that tier 2.
It also
lose about 50% of the HP.
Yeah, it also just forces Splice to base and react.
Yeah,
you're saying, you know, and it keeps HDK in control, because if they go for Dragon and they finish, then they give over the map control to Splice here. Dragon as a whole will just never be prioritized as an objective until first tower has fallen. But we saw it there as well, you know, tower leads to 100% win rate so far. So statistically speaking, HDK is going to win the game, right?
That's how it works?
Yeah.
Guaranteed now. You can just tune out, right? No longer any need to cast. Now, of course, a little bit more factors going in. We'll have to see if Splice can bring it back.
Oh!
It is mostly even, but the disrespect is not clearly in the favor of Jankos, as he steals away that blue buff and says, I'll pick up a dragon. Nice consolation prize as well.
You know, he tried to hide the smirk so hard when he stole it. You know, just like, cool. That was all planned. But they're going to get a dragon off the back of this as well, so Jankos can be pretty happy with the number of jungle camps that he's clearing 50 minutes into the game.
When is Splice going to switch up his lane assignments? When are Tahm Kench and Jhin going to play in the mid lane and put Taliyah bot?
Now, I would say.
Great analysis.
Interesting.
I could be that one for you.
Nice. Solid synergy there, guys. Really making it work. Of course, looking in the jungle, 23 CS advantage coming over to Jankos. Power of that early TM, Matt, letting him clear out so quickly. And you can tell that Trashy's been forced to respond across the map.
And now another play is possible as Trashy steals away this wolf.
Not a blue buff, but
Mickey basically tells his team, look at me. I'm the Taliyah now, you know? They can push up mid and roam top and dive 4v1 on Odoamne whenever they can. All they need to do is clear out this wave. Senkrix can't join then, but if he matches Vladimir bot, the remaining part of the map can be played 4v4. HDK have less pick potential, I feel, unless they land an arrow. That is their main.
Ooh, there's the arrow. That's the knockup. Mickey has a lot of health, but Trashy's on the way in. So is the Weaver's wall. In comes the curtain call. Forgiven, knock back. No denial from the Taric ult. Solid combo from Splice.
I was going to criticize the wall initially, but then the ultimate came out from Trashy to knock them over, and the fight's not over yet.
Oh, Ryu locked up. In goes the Hemo Plague. He's knocked down, though. He's going to pull out, looking for that safety. Senkux knocks him back. Odo on the way in. Wonder, has he overstepped? Exhaust comes in.
Exhaust
comes out.
I think Vedius, we all noticed that wall being a little wonky. I think Forgiven got caught too. It's like staring in the sun directly. He got blinded. He didn't flash anything of Trashy's combo whatsoever.
Really impressive to see overall that the combo between them, the fact that you have the Gragas Assault knocking them over the side of the wall.
Forgiven and became a volleyball ball.
He did. I mean, it was like such great setup.
And done.
I'm looking forward to getting the replay, but right now HDK, they don't lose a turret off the back of it, which means that no real gold swing is going to go in the favor of Splice. But have a look at this. You can already see the wave gets pushed up by Taliyah. She's making her way up. Mickey is just drawing attention, soaking up a lot of the damage. He has the gray health, so he's not going to be that upset. And this wall, not going to hit anyone. Boom! It splits apart HDK. The Taric ultimate doesn't provide the invulnerability, and then Forgiven gets left out to dry.
Yeah, I get a lot of joy when I see a Gragas go for a flash combo into ulti and doesn't try to like weave one auto attack in between, because that's the frame where Forgiven could have flashed. There was nothing Forgiven could have done there, because he didn't see the Gragas coming, because he came out of a brush that wasn't warded. So that was just masterfully executed from Splice. And now they're taking control of the game, you know, using that Tahm Kench to bait out some damage, and then using the globals to either start the fight or join the fight.
I could just imagine that dramatic moment where Forgiven reaches out his hand for Vanda, trying to desperately grab on, but he's just not in range.
The sunglasses coming down. He wants it so bad to be K, but it's simply not. And Splice, we were so critical of them making over-aggressive moves, but this game, it seems like they've figured it out. They've sorted out what they need to do, and the mechanical execution from Trashy.
It's one kill.
It's one kill. The mechanical execution from Trashy was excellent.
They have 800 gold. So it's better. It's definitely an improvement in game one. And this is typically where Splice excel. They're very much about a mid to late game team. And the fact that they haven't succumbed to the relentless pressure of Jankos in the early game is definitely a step in the right direction for Splice.
Yeah, there is quite a large farm lead here, though. Jankos, honestly, not as relentless in his pressure because he spent more time farming, but he still had the right pressure in the right moments, I feel.
It's or when he goes to lane, it's tax, mate.
Tax.
You know, you've got to pay your taxes if you want that sort of pressure.
Yeah. Like, you want a gang? It's going to cost you 4 minions.
Yeah, exactly.
It's for the good of everyone. It's for the good of everyone. Protection fees.
Protection from the mob.
We just want to make sure that your business is safe. You know, you wouldn't want anything to happen, do you?
Well, I have to pay Crepo every day. That's a nice desk you got over there, Vedius.
It would be a shame if somebody would break a leg.
Can't let the secrets of our office out into the real world, gentlemen. People aren't going to approve of the way Crepo does business.
Hey, we all gotta make ends meet, all right?
Hey, tough world. I'm just the pawn of the official linchpin, you know? He sends me on the muscle, you know, he's the brains.
You're so fast to rat him out. The FBI doesn't even show up. You're just like, yep, yeah, DeFicio, please.
Well, he's technically not in the building. New colors coming in on his turf. He's got to assert dominance.
Wondering. Right. Keeps trying to assert dominance. Keeps missing those wallops, though. Odawame made more than comfortable in this matchup. Gnar doing a little bit better for him this time. You can see the massive CS advantage built up here. Balanced out by the CS advantage in the jungle for Jankos.
Splice have to always be a little bit careful, though, because there's always that enchant crystal arrow that could fly out. Especially because you're seeing the map with no. There it is. Mickey's gonna take it.
Arrow,
good flash. I really respect it. Would have had to flash offwards, anyways. That's the kind of pressure you're looking for.
They bought the teleport out of Odo as well, which means that this next Drake that's coming in about a minute's place here and gonna be a much better position to try and contest. It's probably
just need one hit. Blade. Yeah, just one hit so he can get the other flourish. If that connects, then there's another body slam flash coming out from Thrashy here, so. All it takes is one tag, because then W from Jhin can snare people.
One thing I did notice was the pickup of this very early. Ooh, hang on a second, Mickey.
Oh, in trouble. Grayskin gonna get used. He's gonna get stunned up. Not a whole lot of hope for him to make it out.
You noticed the pickup of Tom Kench?
Mickey, yeah.
Yes.
Unfortunately, that Aegis is not gonna do very much for him as he gets caught out of position there. Just wanted to mention that it was a really good buy against this AP as now the ultimate's forced out from Banda.
Beaver's wall, Jankos caught between a rock and a hard place, is going to make it out. One more, Otto Wonder gets it. Aggressive moves, comes in. Jankos, a brief glimmer of hope, silenced.
Wonder walking down, saving his teleport to go back to the tower if needed, just getting extra presence in these fights, because again, you know, one auto attack that slows people with the frozen mallet is enough, you know, to just peel and let the damage land. They don't need Mickey if they can just go offensive at all times. Mickey is only needed there if they need like a defensive action, you know, a devour to reset the fight, maybe dodge some CC.
And I like the response from Senkex, because you can see here that Mickey, unfortunately, face checks the brush, is not expecting Jankos to be there, and he ends up giving away his life. But then you can already see on your minimap that Taliyah is making her way towards the mid lane. This is where the Weaver's Wall is going to cut off the escape. And because H2K feel pretty confident, note that Forgiven does not have any mana.
Yeah, it's also because Odoamus chose tough without teleport here, which prompts the engagement of Splice. If they've done their homework, and that's a big auto from Wunder there.
Yeah.
Ends up expending his flash in the end. That's Jankos.
Yeah.
It's like one time.
Guys, can't let him hit me like that. Not okay.
Need to work on my lip reading. Need to get anything out of that shot. But
the like in his
I just make stuff up.
Furiously shaking to express his distaste in giving away double bump. I worked so hard for them, guys. So hard.
Steal it with the Prey Seeker. He just leaves every time. Of course. I mean, we have to say, good stun from Vander to minimize the losses there, because that flash forward was not to secure the kill onto Jankos. That was looking for more, looking for that Mega Gnar and that ultimate. But H2K, grab their second Drake of the game, or not! Or that's for you. Okay, all right.
Play by play.
All right.
There's actually a more famous instance of May rest in Jaws, I think it was casting like, oh my god, they're invading between two towers. Oh, there's the team. So you're not the first one to make that mistake.
I just saw Ryu like cautiously approaching the pit. I'm like, why is he cautiously approaching the pit? Like, health bars, colors, all I see is Vlad going for a dragon. He does get it.
Hey,
so Jankos maybe needs to work on the smite a little bit, but...
Happens to the best of us, Sifa.
It's all right. And also the most mediocre of us.
We're all in this together, apparently, Crepo.
Jankos getting engaged on Thrashy, just putting on some pressure. There is a Vladimir in the bottom lane here, so this is honestly where Splice is looking to force, because they don't want more damage on that tier 2, and any deadly forest connecting will turn into a really big fight here. They could also path to Baron, honestly, and set up a bait.
Look at the bottom lane, though. Big wave was just shoved in by Ryu, forcing Senkex to be drawn away from this aggression in mid, and has to go and deal with this wave, which is now splitting up Splice, and really preventing them from really continuing on with this aggression. But with the bats of Forgiven and Jankos, they may very well look to re-push onto this mid-tier one.
Yeah, but it's actually what prompted the initial pick-off attempt from Splice here. But in failing, so obviously they lost two waves of farm here. So that's the kind of trade-off that you're looking for. Now, real turret under siege. But Ryu now has the pressure. So they're waiting for bot lane priority. The second they push it out, every time Vladimir catches bot wave, there is a moment where Splice can go aggressive and get a fight going 4v4, but Taliyah will join much quicker. That is kind of the thing they're looking for. They pushed out bot lane. They're going to send Ryu back soon, or H2K is going to neglect that bottom wave and just hard engage mid. Because they know if they send Ryu to the bottom lane, there's a major opportunity for Spice to strike in mid and potentially rotate to Baron.
Clearing out a bit of the trinket vision. Had Jankos there as well, maybe looking for the 2v1 onto the Taliyah. But Odo on the top side consistently getting pressured out and running out of mana very quickly.
Yeah, they want mid-prior right now, get the wave done. And now Vander's actually face-checking into Trashy here, but gets the ward in.
Now, to be careful, you can tell Splice still playing very carefully around the Taric ultimate.
So Ryu's in the mid lane, and that bottom wave is pushing out.
Thing is, for H2K, they're very hesitant to pull the trigger because their ideal target would be to land the Ash Arrow onto Kabi. You then get the immediate follow-up from Jankos and Ryu. But with that Tahm Kench ever present, if you ever try and go for that pick, he's just going to get gobbled up and taken to safety. So it's something that H2K are trying to play around, but it's so difficult for them to really pull the trigger on this Splice composition.
Yeah, same for Splice, though. They had perfect Baron control. But both blue trinkets used. One is still remaining in the pit, I believe. The combination of two scrying orbs in addition to Hawkshot makes it very hard to go for these plays. But they couldn't translate that pushing advantage in the bottom lane into anything real on the map. And we're looking at a very, honestly, stale mid game so far.
Yeah, not seeing a whole lot of action whatsoever. And I think a lot, as you mentioned earlier, due to these supports, both Taric and Tahm Kench so good at denying over aggressive plays, turning them. And the team who's getting engaged on's favor, so maybe paying too much respect to each other, but neither team looking to give up any advantage whatsoever.
Interesting that Trashy looks to be going towards the Iceborne Gauntlet itemization. A bit more damage in his kit will also add to the utility. Something that we do see from Gragas occasionally, just to add a bit of extra oomph in your punch. But also with Wonder picking up that two-item spike, something that we have heard from a number of top laners that Gnat really is quite the powerhouse once he has this Frozen Mallet and Black Cleaver combo, which is why Odo is being very submissive in this lane, because he's a little bit too afraid to go aggressive on this two-item now.
Yeah, it enables the duelist power in him. Once he connects an attack that slows, he ramps up over time. I mean, Odo on him is very unlikely to die, because he can always go back in time with the ultimate, but it just means that Spice always has the pressure here. Senka should be safe on side lanes. It's all about finally forcing something in mid somehow and allowing both side lanes to collapse here. That's what they're doing right now. Gnar pushed up and it's going to roam here.
Vlad moving down, looking to match the Taliyah. Odo looking for a 1v1 in the jungle. But this trade gets just as harder and harder as it extends. Potential setup coming in. Wonder is on the back line. Tower now set to fall. Early Taric ultimate, but Vander's locked up. They could look to chain the CC. Are just going to back off.
And I like that Wunder doesn't commit there. Like, he saw that it was maybe iffy at best, iffy ulties. But instead, you know, they just use the pressure from a flanking Gnar, who has a lane lead over his direct opponent, and they translate that into mid tower. And now that mid tower falls, it is just so important in the current metagame that you can get that tower down, because you can push the wave in deeper, and then you get way better access into enemy jungle, deep ward, set up for Nashor, set up for Dragon here. It's so paramount to getting, honestly, map dominance that you take the mid tower down.
And now, Trashy, he could have looked to rotate around bottom, given that Odo had already been chunked out prior after his 1v1 against Wonder, but they're just going to rely on Wonder already being dominant in that 1v1 to just slowly push down that tier 1 turret. This will be the final objective for them to pick themselves up, and this is a big contrast to game 1 where they couldn't even get themselves a turret.
Yeah, and if Taric right now groups up with the Rek'Sai to go for the, like, the famous Jankos Vander roaming synergy, at least for giving alone, that means Kabe can just actually go for WR combo and almost one-shot him.
And not only that, as we get later and later into the game, Baron is very much an objective that's on the table. Committing that many members to the bottom side with so limited global mobility could be a death sentence if they're not cable. But the story here for me just feels like Odo got ahead in game 1, and this time around, Jankos wasn't able to find that advantage, and it's so much easier for Wonder now.
Yeah, it's the nature of the matchup, however. It was a really good combined effort from HDK to play the map, influence both side lanes, but Spice kind of kept the door shut this game.
We also have to bear in mind that HDK voluntarily chose to give in 3 weaker lanes. Now, Jankos going for a play.
Oh, nice flash out. We're looking for a bit more here. Ryo steps forward, teleports coming in, but Gnar's already taken a tower on the bottom side. Splice extend their gold advantage, and H2K walk away empty-handed.
This is the power of the disengage available on Splice. They weren't quite able to land the arrow onto Mickey, and then any further pursuit from H2K would have just really been for nothing, because you still had the consume available on Mickey, you also had the disengage from Kobe and the barrel from Trashy, and now they're looking to pick themselves up their first dragon of the series.
Yeah, but they're playing into Mini Gnar, which now the Gnar transformation will be on cooldown. Weave as well comes out for a zone here. That means they have to kind of burn down this dragon. Did it reset? No, it did not reset. So that's a great use of Weave as well there.
Smart utilization overall. Of course, Senkuk's one of the more experienced players, but H2K looking to get back the mid lane tower, and they are going to be able to grab it. Deadly Flourish comes in, Curtain Call as well. Tower has not fallen yet. Trashy's on the back line. Odo snaps back, is invulnerable as they push for more, but Splice are ready for a fight. They're pushing forward. Wonder's knocked up. Vladimir goes in. H2K, they're going to pick up one. Ryu backing off, maybe looking for a bit more. Tides of Blood goes in. Senkux is so low, but he's not scared. Ryu in the back lines. Ryu dropping down. It's going to be the one for one.
Ah, the spatial awareness of this Splice team as they run. Nobody too afraid to just blindly run away from this Vladimir. And they turn around and they actually take down Ryu. Mostly Trashy leading that re-engage. Tower still looking to drop, though.
Tower is going to go down in the end. So many low health bars, but no one else going
to
drop.
And Wonder trying to go back into that fight when he did not have his Mega Gnar available. This is something that we were talking about prior to taking the dragon. Splice were a little bit too afraid to commit because they didn't have the Mega Gnar available. And because it had just gone on cooldown, there was no real way for them to get any big advantage in this fight.
Yeah, but look, they don't just mindlessly go in. They force a fight, disengage off the Taric ulti. Now it's okay, they're waiting. Biding the time, Ryu is the one that says, okay, guys, follow up on Yankos' three-man knockup. So that's honestly very well played here. I don't think Splice could have done much here. But then right here, I really like the fact that they somehow get Ryu. Like, they actually realize that they can turn around, deal some damage, and Senkux on 10% still has the presence of mind to turn around and get a kill.
Problem for Ryu, they're using his pool aggressively to chase after his opponents. It's not how you want to be using that Sanguine pool, simply because it's going to enable you to get locked up against the single target CC chain that Splice has available, and they get the kill. And now Arrow on the Trashy.
And that's the problem with Arrow. You always need to aim for Tahm Kench here. And that's why Mikey is honestly building those Murk cuts himself. He can save any pickoff attempt with Devour, and obviously, it's not like you can trade cooldowns. You can trade Hook for Devour, but Arrow for Devour. Devour is always going to win, so that's what makes it so hard for HGK to actually really force something unless they flank with Echo.
And this is why, last week, something that we were discussing is why aren't we seeing very much Ashe in the meta right now? Why isn't she as potent as we initially thought she would be? And in part, you have to wonder whether or not it is due to this Tahm Kench and Taric that we've been seeing a lot of, because their ability to keep these single targets alive at the risk of this Arrow engage is just so effective. It mitigates a lot of what Ashe can bring to the table.
And when we look at the champions in the meta as well, I mean, especially in the case of Taric, you do have a window to burst those champions down, but Taliyah, Vladimir, not known to just instantly be able to burst someone. These are not assassins.
Ooh. With top lane being a dead lane right now, there was actually potential roam going down from Senkux down to bot. If he can surprise Odwamne and Splice have enough vision control to contest Baron long enough 3v4, they can actually do a surprise play here where Odwamne is expecting the 1v1 and yield, but then Senkux randomly shows up here.
Trashy throwing down a bit of pressure in the mid lane as well. Yankos is around, this is Vander. H2K maybe looking for an engage in the mid lane, but they have to respect the bottom lane right now.
Yeah, but they spotted him, you know. Radar spotted Senkux here, but they're actually just setting up a rotation for themselves here, bypassing Yankos, hopefully, and putting pressure on the tier 2 here. Wave's gone.
No wave. Not going to be a whole ton of damage there. Just a few autos, but the top lane is now left unattended, and the wave is pushing in the favor of Splice.
Also note the number of wards set up from Splice around that Baron. Wonder is doing a good job of just keeping Odo underneath his turret, and this is enabling Splice to posture around that objective. But until they really get a really good fight, it's not something that they can try and just instantly go for. They might just commit for it anyway.
Of course, now setting their sights on the Baron, and they are going to start this one up.
Remember, they have Weaver's Wall to cut up entrance to this Baron here.
So they are going to use
they
it.
They used it.
They're going to use it to block it off. H2K limited option. Senkux is stunned up, but there is no follow-up. TP on the way in. Yanko's moving into the pit. Baron at half health, but it's healing up.
They went for the play without checking pit first. You always check pit first for the wall because it could have bought you maybe 3 or 4 seconds before H2K reacted. Right now, H2K operated under complete information. But Splice have shown their hand. H2K are now aware that this is one of the plays that's in Splice's plays book.
Now aware of the potential for this Filial wall, but additionally, H2K have to give up that TP, so maybe an advantage that Splice can capitalize on.
But note that Odo did use his teleport in that play, which means that Splice still have the advantage. You can send Gnar down to the bottom lane. There's already a big minion wave pushing in their favor. He can just continue to what he's doing, and Splice can just repeatedly play around this Baron.
You can already see how confidently he is winning that match of a 70 CS advantage, the GA, the Spirit Visage, all these damage items as well between the Frozen Mount and the Black Cleaver. But Trashy looking to make something happen. Ryu, no fear though, just sidesteps. This could be the engage. Wonder goes Mega and backs off. Tempered aggression from both sides.
Yeah, it was a good try by Splice. Deadly Flourish connects. That becomes a brawl right there. It's all honestly contingent on Kabi landing that W spell, because if Voodoo target, so easy to beat up on, and if he's running away, then Jin can follow with ulti. It took Spice quite a long time to get complete control here of this area. Actually, having some turbulence, he's flying through river.
A little shakier than he wanted it. The international flight, if you will. All right, Splice once again trying to regain control over the pit. They may have shown one play in their playbook.
I mean, they can repeat it. They just need to get complete control over Baron within the cooldown of teleport. That is their one limiting condition.
They do need to set up the top lane too, because there is a bit of a big minion wave pushing in favor of H2K. They can just send Senkux up there. He can quickly clear things out, and then they can start to cluster around the Baron once again. But they do need to clear this vision out. They have control right now. They have the mid lane priority.
But they don't have enough pink wards, honestly. Spice is trying to build a house without all the tools that they need. Good flash here again from Mickey.
Oh, Yankos looks for the knockup. Odo looking for the chain CC. They are going to get it, but out comes the curtain call. Ultimate comes in from the Taric. Will buy them a bit of time, but Wonders on the side. No Meganar available yet, but he's impossible to get away from. That's a massive burst of damage. Vander is knocked back. No way out, but Odo going to get the stun. Mickey going to save his laner, and Ryu getting burned down. In comes more aggression. Senkux goes over the wall, but pops off on the wrong side. Vander gets knocked out. Wonder looks for the combo. Finally going to connect, and Odo will fall to the Deathfire Grass, no, to the Deadly Flourish.
Yeah, Sky Leader Senkux redirecting the pathing, says, you shall now pass H2K. Take a left right here, and that allows Wunder to chase down, and they get two kills here. Really well played by Splice. It was H2K trying to force a fight, because they knew if they wait any longer, they would lose this Baron eventually due to vision control. Now it's up to Yanka. First Blood King has to find a way to potentially steal this, but all he has is a tunnel.
Moving in. Oh, they get it in the end. A barely able to secure it on the side of Splice. Yankos trades his life, Ryu trades his life, and Splice get it in the end.
That could have been a KT Rocks Baron over again, but fortunately enough, Splice get the play, Splice get another kill, and with four kills on the board and Baron, they're looking to break into H2K's base.
And pop goes the AD carry. Dominance comes in from Splice. Confidence in their shot calling. They don't even need a minion wave. They've got the raw power on this lineup to burn through the tier 2 tower, and it may be costing them, but there's nothing H2K can do.
Yeah, suddenly we have an entirely different game 2 here, and honestly a fantastic start to the series with very high priority on this Delia, and we can see why, you know, key influencing of this fight. I like that H2K was willing to pull the trigger there, because they were slowly being squeezed out. This play pattern could have been repeated over and over and over, you know, the dominating matchup of the first rotation Gnar in the bottom lane. H2K is like, guys, we need to deal with this, otherwise Wunder's gonna split push our base to shambles. So they send in Yankos, and again, forgiving with the right arrow, anybody else than Mickey, he will eat them. So you need to get Mickey, but Mickey presses the vine to early flash, and then obviously, Tom Kench wants nothing more to soak some damage.
And Kobe holding on to his ultimate as well. He realized that the Taric ult had come out. There was no point in wasting it. He chunks out Forgiven, and that forces him back. And then they're just waiting for Meganar to come into fruition.
And then right here, Senkux could have maybe carried on, flying a little bit further on that wall, and then pop up to kill Forgiven, but the damage was done. Reroutes the entire team to enable Wunder to get a stun onto Echo, and then, yeah, it was curtain call for H2K.
And that is just one of the many beautiful ways in which you can use that Weaver's Wall, whether it be cut off an escape or just cut off the opponent from trying to force you from doing these objectives. And now HGK
forcing a fight. Looking for a fight. Stun does come in. Weaver's Wall on the way. Senkux blocking this off. Wonder on the wrong side. They cancel the wall instantly. Odo is knocked back. Ryu dishing out damage on the front side. It's the extended fight. Snap back from Odo. He moves forward looking for the stun. He's going to get the shield, but nothing else. He's knocked back. Senkux on a killing spree as Splice move into the mid lane.
You can hear the Danish fans getting excited about Splice's dominance right now. They have the Baron, and they're just going to keep on pushing.
Yeah, H2K, they were looking for a play, but from a window of opportunity, they went to the wall of Taliyah, and Splice complete control here. One inhib down, still Baron buff is ticking for maybe 30 seconds to a minute more.
And H2K have to be sweating after a play like that. Splice moving on to the top side, ready to take down another tower. But H2K not going to give it up for free. Splice sees him coming on the ward. This could be another fight.
Thing is, if you're H2K, you realize that this Splice team is so powerful at this point in the game. They have a Baron as well, and so rather than trying to force a fight when you're going up against a minion wave like this, they try to force a play in the mid lane where their odds are a little bit better. But unfortunately for them, the gold difference is too big. The wall to cut off a really good use of what could have been Vander's ultimate just did not work out in their favor. And you can just see the setup initially is very promising. They try to nuke down Mickey, but then this wall to just cut off the two teams. Now Vanda's ultimate is completely useless, and that's when Splice can go for the read.
Yeah, and the worst part about this wall is like, it kind of has a shadow first and then the wall comes after, but because you know it's coming, it is one of the biggest zoning tools out there, really. Senkux just immediately pulls the trigger, and then Splice, they save themselves first and then they reevaluate. And obviously they're playing here with two Infernos too. Like 50-50 dragon splits, but Splice have the better selection of the menu.
It works out so well because the early game control for H2K only nets them a Cloud and an Ocean, not what you want, with Elder Dragon potentially next on the table, giving you the equivalent of a third Infernal Drake as well as that burn buff. I mean, there's really just not a single major objective that H2K can afford to give up. All that's left are these Inhibitors and Baron as well as the Elder Dragon.
And it is so hard to fight the Splice team right now. Talia, level 18. Death Cap and Void Staff completed. You thought that she was hard to kite, but, or you thought she was good at kiting before. Well, now when she's got a Wizard Hat to boot, it's just going to make it so much more impactful. And when you look at Jhin as well, Infinity Edge and the Dustblade of Drakfar finished, it just really spells dismay for H2K.
And earlier I mentioned that there might not be enough burst damage on this lineup, but with this many items, with this big of a lead, we saw Forgiven get deleted in an instant, and it could be just as similar of a story for Ryu, for Odo, if they overextend, if they get caught out.
Splice right here, honestly looking to repeat the same thing. This time they go for a 3-1-1, and they're actually, look at what they're doing with Senkix. Really smart gameplay. Instead of trying to force it at the base, they just put Senkix in the lane wherever Wunder is winning, and then they back off right now. They have to be careful, because on top side, Ryu's looking for an engage as well.
Splice starting out here, gonna have to see what happens. Ryu's pushing forward, Splice looking to lock him down, Protobelt, but he still gets locked up in the end. Curtain call for a little bit of damage on the back half. Vander shielding up, Weaver's Wall on the way in. Wonder, has he overstayed his welcome? He's still Mininar. Ryu maybe looking for the turn. Alt comes in from Tark. He's immune to damage for a few seconds. Mickey, the savior that he may need. They're moving in. Trashy getting aggressive once more. It's a bloodbath on each side, but the Talia does so much damage. Oh! Wonder knocks him back. They're knocked down. Kabi dominating. Ryu buys a few seconds, but he drops hard.
Yeah, back and forth five initiated by H2K as they tried to cross map the aggression from Splice. It was so close, but then Forgiven got knocked up and knocked down by Wunder.
The end of the day, H2K put a good showing in game one, but Splice have adapted in game two, shown us the full power of the Talia, and close out with confidence, 13-2.